The War is Over, The Stone House Series, Chapter 56. Once the honeycomb structure caught fire, it burned fiercely, overloading the senses with sight and sound, roaring up in flames taller than most trees. Lucifer shouted orders above the din. More wood, trees, beams, houses. I don't care what it is, or where you get it. If it burns, throw it in. Then 2 hours later, it finally happened. First, a piece fell here and there, a post, a tree, a log, some creaking, and a little groaning, and then the earth collapsed. An entire circle section of the honeycomb grid gave way with one colossal snap, crackle, crinkle, whoosh, boom, poof. The falling cloud of inferno cast sparks 100 yards in all directions. The bigger chunks fell 100 feet, and there collected, whereupon, spurred on by the lava streams in which they landed, the fire flamed hotter, higher, consuming everything and every creature nearby and underneath. Massive warbling heat waves came back up through the burned out section, shimmering, rolling, distorting every sight seen across and through them. Lucifer screamed, "Yes, I've broken through the gates of hell and into prison." Loki watched his master through the fire, his face and form perverted, stretching, shrinking, his voice muddy through the heat waves with the madness of his obsession. "I will set my warriors free. I will drive a stake through the heart of Jesus, and I will anchor him to the stones of hell forever. I will slaughter the ones who think that he is so special. And then I will go find his father and finish what I started so many years ago." He maneuvered, turning, glaring down the hole, straining to see through the heat waves and flames of fire. Among flickering candles and silent shadows, friends were chatting and waiting for what they knew would happen next. Simon said, "It was at the Feast of Tabernacles Jesus spoke from the prophets Isaiah and Jeremiah. He stood up and shouted it out, and he said, 'If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture says, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.'" He was quoting from Jeremiah, where Lord God said, "For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water." And from the voice of God that came through Isaiah, "Ho, every one that thirst, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price." Almighty God identified himself as living water and the source of spirit food to eat. And Jesus said that the ones who believe on him, that we will have his rivers of living water flow out of our spirit selves. Martha said, I'm trying to remember what Jesus said about this when he was at our house, just after he raised Lazarus from the dead." "Martha, he spoke to you personally about this?" "Well, yes, something about after I am born of God, choosing to let the life of God in me flow out of my spirit self, or your spirit self. But it's as you have said before, we are walking and talking about a womb that we haven't walked into yet." Mary longingly remembered, when Jesus talked about these things, he made everything so clear and easy to see. I hope this spirit helper he spoke of will help us see things clearly again. I like cloud-free thoughts, not fuzzy thoughts. I like my thoughts to be crisp and precise. Esther was muddling around in a thought. When morning comes, it will be halfway through the first day of the week, the third day Jesus spoke of. How will we know when Jesus comes alive again? And from when do we start counting? 3 days and three nights? Is it 3 full days and nights, and like how tomorrow started a few hours at sundown? He said that as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so would the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. They beat on him before the cross for over 6 hours. Doesn't that count for something? When are they counting time? Those watching at the fence had been intent in one direction and never realized that they were surrounded until they were. Every resident in the place of protection had been moving down the hill and towards the pit to stand against the horde. Queen Esther silently arrived beside her uncle. John the Baptizer was not so quiet when he placed both hands upon the fence. He shouted words of victory right past the monster dragon to his Messiah, somewhere within hell's expanse. David, Jonathan, Mordecai, Anna, Michael, each turned surveying those who had gathered. All of God's people who had left their earth suit were all come together, thousands deep for miles in both directions, all along the gorge. Hell's collective observant of Skunk's stretch, bite, nip maneuver was first met with anger, then acceptance, compliance, and finally with desire. And still chained demons were calling out, pleading to be rescued next and bitten free. Following Skunk and Pug's example, several of the free and foot-restored resident dragon demons went off in pairs to set their brothers free. Watching Skunk from high above and dropping to his hands and knees, Lucifer crawled up to the opening's edge, his head tucked within a cooling, circling updraft created by the rising heat wave movement. "Skunk, is that you down there?" beneath a row of white horn crowns. "Pug, you too." Ugly Pug in a handsome dragon body. "You both look so majestic, so fantastic. But what about your wings? They're rather puny." As Lucifer observed Skunk, like a young eagle in its nest, reared back, rose up, and flapped his bone and leather wings. Although they could not lift him off the ground, the air wash from them raised up a cloud of sparks from the fire's base 100 feet away. The swirling sparks rose up and passed a racing streamers only inches in front of Lucifer's sniffing nose. "Oh, yes. Wow. Beautiful. Oh, so nice. Although your wings are not yet fit for flying, they are growing grandly. This is bigger and better than when I flew through Adam's garden the day I took these puny humans as my prize." Desire climbed into Lucifer's eyes as lust spread throughout his body, with each breath remembering Skunk's transforming passage into hell. Loki bumped Skunk in, and he was not damaged, but instead transformed. What would happen now? One of his remaining volunteers was crouching right beside him, and Lucifer glanced at those around him, wondering, calculating. No one's watching. And with the slightest movement, Lucifer gave a push and then cried out, "Oh no, help someone, catch him quick." But it was far too late and none could be the demon's rescue. Oh, with eyes watching, the screaming demon tumbled and transformed into a majestic dragon. He landed gently, but he landed in the raging fire's center. Lucifer, watching in horror as the beautiful new dragon suit began to smoke, squirreling around violently, until at last the scaly skin began to bubble and burn away. Ah, this is true sadness. What a waste. He must find a better way. He shouted down the open hole, "Break the fire up, kick it all apart. You must put the fire out so we can come inside." Hearing their master's voice, many of Hell's prisoners were instantly set to motion, quickly, although cautiously, tearing out burning trees and timbers from the fire. To his topside demon leader, Lucifer instructed, "Loki, a chain. We must have a chain. An anchored climbing entrance in, and yes, I know. There must have been an anchor chain from the boat you threw inside. Send for someone to get it and bring it in." Lucifer scanned the space around them and, pointing at some boulders, he instructed, "Hook the boat anchor between those two side-by-side boulder rocks and drop the chain inside." His demons, each anxious to receive their own dragon suit, instantly retrieved the chain and hooked it into the rocks. "Yes, now throw it in," clank, clunk, whoosh, dip, tunk. The chain dropped into Hell, with the final end whipping back and forth, whacking several unsuspecting demons about their scaly dragon heads. Still crouching topside, Lucifer surveyed his chained hanging place and it swung inside the fire's edge. "Pug, quick, pug, before it gets too hot, catch onto the chain's last link and pull it over. Away from the bed of coals, pull it over." With his teeth, Pug latched into the swinging chain and backed up, pulling it towards the iron fence, the bottomless pit, and the watchers in the distance. Maneuvering, selecting an open landing spot before him, Pug then planted his dragon feet and stood waiting. 1/4 mile away, over an iron fence and across an almost bottomless pit, and then over an iron fence, Mordecai asked a question. "Ah, Michael, you are the only angel I see in here. Aren't you going to bring some reinforcements in here with us? There must be a bunch of you guys around somewhere, you know, just in case." "Nope." David eyed the league of demon dragons across the pit, looking nasty. "Okay, how long before Jesus, you know, comes alive again? And what will happen when he does?" Michael answered, "Patience, David. He almost has his head inside the noose."